Around the World with MS World. I'm Dr. Daniel Cantor. Here at ACTRIMS 2017, we're learning more about environmental factors. We heard about diet, and we're hearing about things like the microbiome, so what's going on in the gut, but we're also hearing about viruses and other aspects that are similar to viruses, and that's why I'm so happy to be joined here by Professor Dolet, who's a full professor of virology at University of Sassari in Italy. You talked about something called HERV. I know that probably no one listening has heard of this. What are we talking about?
We're talking about viruses that entered our progenitors millions and millions of years ago, and that entered our genome and have been preserved until these days. The majority are heavily inactivated. Some of them have been used by the human body for instance to allow implantation of a human embryo during the pregnancy and other beneficial effects. Sometimes some of them can be activated by several triggers, and if their expression is in the wrong way, let's say within the brain, their potential can reveal neuropathogenic, and it has been experimental proved in animal models that the expression of the special protein of these endogenous retroviruses of their W family can account for activation of molecular pathways that can account for inactivation of astrocytes and of degeneration of the myelin formation. And what we have found in several studies through years and years is that the expression of this endogenous retrovirus of the W family precedes the onset of the disease, can predict our worst behavior up to 10 years later, and it is associated with the disease, and it's reduced during effective therapy. And there are phase 2 clinical trials with antibodies against this protein, and we are anxious to see what will happen.
So what you're saying, I think, is that as opposed to viruses that people get, you know, like the flu virus that we're getting right now, these are viruses that entered into our genes long, long time ago. So a long, long time ago, and entered into the human genome, and some of those things are beneficial and some of those things might not be beneficial. That's why they're called human endogenous, so they're part of our body. It's not a virus coming from outside, and it's a retrovirus.
Yes.
Which kind of goes backwards, so it goes into our genes. And so having these within our body might be why for a long time we've looked for a virus in MS and we haven't found one. It might be it was actually inside our own DNA the whole time.
Well, I don't want that the concept passes that all these materials is tremendously dangerous, because around 10% of our genome is alienic, is composed of this retroviral material. So if we survived for 50, 70 million years, so these elements cannot be too dangerous. Otherwise, we would disappear a long time ago. But sometimes a wrong expression in the wrong place with a combination of different factors and operating, of course, in a predisposing genetic background can induce this virus to go on and to operate the pathogenic potential.
So then is there something that reactivates these in a way that then puts a person at risk for MS getting worse or for even developing MS?
Well, 10% of healthy persons have production of this virus normally in their blood, and it doesn't do anything. The problem is in the wrong context with activation, for instance, with the Epstein-Barr virus or herpes simplex virus, that can activate the cells that are thought to cross the blood-brain barrier, and in this context, inside the brain, the story may reveal dangerous.
And then is our hope that we could develop some sort of antibody or something that sticks to that and then would halt it a little bit for somebody with MS?
Immune defense, autonomous immune defense are not relevant, but there are trials just starting now. There is a French group which is in a phase 2A clinical trial, so it's very early. But they obtained, they treated with antibodies, monoclonal antibodies against this the protein of this endogenous retrovirus, animals with EIE, that is a mouse model of MS, obtaining a benefit on the clinical course, so that the data are quite encouraging, but it takes time, of course.
Well, I want to thank you so much for really opening our eyes for what, for a lot of people, is the first time they've ever heard of this concept, this idea that millions and millions of years ago, we actually had other parts stuck into our own DNA, and it makes up not an insignificant, about 10% of what we think of as human is actually not coming from human beings. And so that may play a role in helping with some things like you brought up in terms of the fetus being implanted in the mother, but then it may also be problematic in things like multiple sclerosis. It may be why we keep looking for a virus that causes MS and we can't find it, because we may be looking for outsiders.
You see, you cannot look to a single agent, because like a cancer, also MS is the result of cooperation of different agents. Each of them can give a contribute, and possibly we can find how to stop or delay each of, or at least some of these steps.
So MS is complex, and so there's multiple steps, and that's why when people have looked for one thing like Epstein-Barr or human HHV6, so looking at herpes viruses, that may not be the right way, because it's probably a lot more complex. I want to thank you so much for taking a complex topic and breaking it down for us, and I want to thank you at home for watching.